What I plan to do is really to say a couple of things about my association with AIBOC, with bank unions, including the Bank Employees Association and BEFI, and with a couple of things, and I'm not going to take long, which I've learned in the process of this association. Well, willy-nilly, because that's my profession. At a certain point of time, I started life working in industrial economics, and soon you begin to look at the problems of financing, capital-intensive industrialization, and then I began to look at finance. And I got quite interested and began teaching courses on finance and so on. And at that point of time, that was also an interesting period, because starting from the 1991, but in fact earlier, starting from after the 1981 IMF loan, which India took, because we took one loan well before the 1991 loan, when things were not so bad, other than for the fact that there was an oil crisis prior to that. At that point of time, there was this fundamental transformation which was beginning to occur in the financial realm in all sorts of underdeveloped countries. Of course, it had started in the southern countries in Latin America much earlier, but one could see it happening. And, you know, this was not just financial liberalization in the sense that you were removing controls for the entry of foreign direct investment, foreign portfolio investment, the entry of foreign banks, foreign insurance companies, etc., which was happening in other countries, not in India at that point of time. But that was actually transforming the financial structure, so that structures of a kind which were used by the developed countries during the period when they were trying to industrialize and grow were being undermined in these countries. And it was exactly the same wherever you went. You went to Nepal and looked at a poverty reduction strategy paper, and they recommended the same thing as they would recommend to India or Brazil or Thailand or Chile. So there was something happening, and I would go to some NGO meets. You know, one gets called because every now and then NGOs need a little bit of an input from an academic, you know, and so you get called. And I would keep telling them that, listen, the problem is not only the IMF and the World Bank. It is true the IMF and the World Bank are problems, but the world is changing. The IMF and the World Bank are going to become far less important. It's actually the transformation of financial structures which is going to determine what's going to happen to the kind of capitalism you have. And in fact, that's turned out to be true, of course. Everybody knew it was going to be true. I mean, the bank really doesn't matter. The IMF comes in only when there's a balance of payments crisis. The real problem is that international finance, in the sense of private international financial capital, networked, of course, with other kinds of capital, has come to dominate these countries. So there was this effort to try and get the NGO community to go beyond, you know, making appeals to the IMF, to the World Bank, having people's, people's courts to look at the kind of policies they were imposing on third world countries and so on, to try and get them to then move on, at least some of them whom I was associated with, to move on to looking at financial problems or the transformation of financial structures and the implications of that. Well, I wasn't successful. And then suddenly at one point of time, one found that the real people opposing financial liberalization and this transformation of financial structures were those within the bank, within the financial system itself. Of course, this was not true only of India. I mean, you know, it was true in many other parts of the world. But in India, this was particularly strong because of the strong public banking tradition that got built up after 1969. And therefore, actually, the effort to try and get some support of people who actually matter, as opposed to a bunch of academics sitting in academic institutions, really seemed to bear fruit when one began to associate with you know, employees and officers in the bank, in the banking sector. And of course, the insurance sector as well. And because in the insurance sector also, we have a movement which has actually stood up quite significantly against liberalization in various forms. So as a result of that association, one of the things which happened was, I think it was 2006, some of us were approached by AIBOC, the then AIBOC. I didn't know Franco really. Well, I think I've run into him as part of the People's Science Network, but not really as part of the Confederation. And And we were approached. In fact, they approached some Shukla Sahab, and they wanted to bring in Prabhat Patnaik, Omiyo Bakchi. I was not all that young then, but definitely much younger than I was today. And they needed somebody to do the work. So they said, yeah, of course. They said, yo, we contacted Chandrasekhar also. Then they said, oh, then we'll be part of it. And this committee was formed, and we actually produced this report. At that time, the experience with AIBOC was very different, because it was true. AIBOC has a strand of radicalism, but it is a complex organization, one felt at that point of time. And it was a very different thing, because we also went from city to city trying to actually get evidence as part of trying to prepare this report, and the way it would be organized, and the kind of people they'd want us to meet, etc., varied given this complex structure. Well, that was done, and then much later, a few years down the line, this relationship continued. One has gone and addressed AIBOC, BEFI, AIBA in different occasions, in different places, etc. And suddenly we get this gentleman taking over AIBOC, and then it all seemed very different. Firstly, I mean, they didn't call me comrade, you know. they just would call me Professor Chandrasekhar. And then suddenly I have this gentleman, you know, ringing me up and saying, comrade, I need to, you know, talk to you. I need to come and meet you. I'll be landing in the airport. Will you be in the office, or will you be at home, etc., etc.? And willy-nilly, he not only got us to do, which came much later, us to do another report or another study for which was an extension or an update on the kind of study which we had done in 2006. But he would constantly get one to look at issues that maybe one would have got to look at, but maybe a little later, maybe one would have missed it. But he would say that, oh, there's this thing coming up, there's this bill, there's that change in policy, this is what the RBI circular says, etc., etc. And one ended up then looking at it, and because you looked at it, you wrote about it. And in some sense, I think I learned a lot because of the fact that we were pushed, even and subsequently also by Soumya, we were pushed into looking at things which maybe some of it we would have looked at, but maybe a lot of it we wouldn't have looked at, because you're doing many things, this is not the only area of research, etc. So it was a learning experience, not only for what we did for AIBOC in the form of these reports, but it was also because of the fact that AIBOC pushed us. But to conclude, what if one I was just thinking, if one was to think of one kind of sort of, let's say, perspective which has come out of this interaction, as opposed to maybe one's own efforts to try and understand these complex changes in the world of finance, I really think, when this interaction began, I could sense a difference, because if you're coming at it as an academic, if you're going to write about it, if you're going to lecture about it, if you go to classrooms and tell students about it, etc., you're always looking for a clear logic. You're always looking for a mechanism. You're always looking at being nuanced, and you don't want to say that, listen, I think there's a conspiracy out here, But the fact of the matter is, capitalism is the biggest con game in town. There is a deep conspiracy which goes on for all of these things. And in some sense, the questions, the way the question would be posed, the way the push would come, would make one think. And I was just thinking, and I'll conclude with that, supposing we just look at what has happened just over the last 3 years, maybe 4 years, since the sort of end of term of Raghuram Rajan. Okay, everybody talks about NPAs. One is talking about resolution, one is talking about bankruptcy code, one is talking about FRDA, DAI bill, etc. But this kind of panic about it really was a phenomenon which began when Raghuram Rajan decided that, listen, let's stop all this thing which was going on for a long period of time, starting with creating the CDC, the Corporate Debt Restructuring Cell, That is, you were actually saying that, listen, these are huge loans we've given to these corporates. We can't declare them as being defaulted debt. We can't provide for them because we'll go insolvent. I mean, that was the game, and it was very clear. You can't afford to do it. So what you needed to do is to find ways to postpone it. And, you know, CEDC, 5x25, you kept, you kept discovering mechanisms by which you can keep this debt going, even though it was not a debt which actually is going to be so easily resolved. Finally, you had to take taxpayers' money, as the United States and England and Europe had to do at the end of the 2007-08 crisis, and clear the books. You just had to clear the books with taxpayers' money, if not today's taxpayers' money over the coming 5-10 years. But then suddenly this Raghuram Rajan says that, listen, you can't hide all this. You have to put it on the books, because, you know, what kind of a game is this? And, you know, he takes these, you know, he makes these statements which you know, all of us are surprised by, you know, that there are these people who think that they can take bank money and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. He used to make these statements. Now, listen, Raghuram Rajan, I mean, he's smart, but he's also a sharp cookie. He wasn't doing it because he believed that, you know, capitalism is a game in which we should be fair, transparent, and so on. It isn't a game like that. So obviously, there was some reason why he was doing it. And I think the reason was the fact that the public banking system in the years of liberalization, starting from the 90s, but particularly during the early 2000s, was used as a mechanism to actually finance a strategy in which you were facilitating the expansion of private capital. It was used as an instrument in what was one of the most intense efforts to redistribute income in favor of the top 1% or top 2% or top 3%. And the banking system, the public banking system, was used as an instrument in this. And if it was being used as an instrument, obviously you're going to accumulate all of this. And what was the implicit understanding was that every now and then the state would come in, and in doses it would recapitalize these banks, which essentially meant that at some point you wrote off this debt. It was a technical write-off, and then if you look at what happens up post technical write-off, nothing really happens. You don't get very much money back. So we might say that, listen, we're getting, you know, 60% and 20% from Bhushan Steel and Power and so on and so forth. But if you look at those numbers, we were getting peanuts. We were getting, you know, I mean, we meaning the public banking system was getting maybe 5%, 3%, 7%, in some cases zero. You just wrote off the whole thing. So that was the understanding, that there would be a continuous process of recapitalization to finance this process of the redistribution, of the engineered redistribution of income in favor of the top few percent. Now, obviously, once you unleashed this game, things had gone so far that if you were simultaneously saying that, listen, I've got a fiscal deficit which I'm not going to let go more than 3%, and you're sitting with all of these you know, corporates having had this ball game for so many years, there's a fundamental contradiction. You can't keep capitalizing. So you begin to think of what you want to do. But at that point of time, I do think the reason why the guidelines on discovering NPAs was changed was because big finance, not just the Ambanis, but international finance as well, saw in this an opportunity to, in some sense, capture the public banking system. Because what is, you know, what would you say? People say that, listen, why are you getting 60% or 70%, they claim, for Bhushan Power? Why is JSW willing to pay whatever it's going to pay, 19,000 crores or something like that for because of the fact, says today's paper, because they think that, you know, setting up greenfield projects just doesn't work in the steel industry. So the much better thing to do is to try and buy steel capacity cheap, in which case you can expand and get away with it. If you try and set up greenfield capacities, you're not going to make profits. Okay, so that's the reason you do it. The same is true of banking. When you have a banking sector which, because of nationalization, has spread itself and established a presence so deep and widespread in this country, to try and come and actually create a new greenfield bank and compete with the public banking system is a no-no. It's a game which just won't work. So the only thing you can do is to capture a pre-existing system. You take over, I don't know why they call it that, you make a brownfield investment. You basically take over something which already exists. And I think the push to actually come clean on NPAs, such that you will be in a position where you'll have a very short period of resolution, which you cannot do on the basis of taxpayers' money, is what set this off. And after that, the game just goes on. Every day there's, you know, there's either, when we are constantly having these, you know, some Indra Danush, then what, Sashat, you know, you just find all these words and it's all the same thing you try. And we had ARCs before, we've tried, set, you know, there's been talk of bad banks. We are now basically saying that, okay, we had IBC, now we won't take everything to IBC, we'll only take some to IBC, some we'll resolve directly, but that's what we were trying to do earlier. So essentially, you're not able to complete this game. You're not able to complete this game of keeping on recapitalizing. But on the other hand, since still we have AIBOC, we have Franco, we have Soumya, we have all of you, we have the insurance workers, we have BEFI, we have AIBEA, and of course some fellow travelers and side hangers on like all of us sitting here, there's a fight back. There's a fight back, and when there's a fight back and you have something as important as the public banking system, it's not so easy to allow private capture of this huge public empire which has been built over a period of time. They're being a little more successful, I think, in insurance, but even they're not in life. And this whole thing, therefore, is, I'm convinced now, one big conspiracy. Maybe 5 years back, I wouldn't have been willing to consider it. But having been converted into a comrade by Franco, I'm willing to consider that this is one big conspiracy. Thank you.